Welcome, welcome, welcome to the April 26, May 26, 216 intensive, and we have Space of Allowance who's agreed to take the intensive, and everyone else here is absolutely welcome to also pay full attention to this, and we'll address the intensive to Space of Allowance, who's very qualified, obviously, to consider all of this. And so what we're going to do right here is to take a look at a very technical detail of abidance. Abidance is our goal. Abidance is our goal. Make no mistake about that. And there's this very important detail that has just come to light. We need to look at this. It makes a difference. We have the right practice for sure. It may seem interesting to people who say, well, you talk about Longchenpo, you know, Vajrayana Buddhism, this isn't Vajrayana Buddhism. No. The way it works is that the Holy Spirit and Jesus assign us to certain crisis response teams where we fit the best. What's the best fit? For me, the best fit is with Longchenpo. I feel natural. I don't feel any discomfort or awkwardness or anything. He's like an unknown, no baggage. You know, it's a fit for me. So the Holy Spirit knows that and assigns me to this. Others might be assigned to other crisis response units. That's fine. It's all good. All the same objective. Reality has no script, actually. So now, Longchenpo, I find, is free of dogma. This is what I feel. There's no dogma there. He's not a dogmatic Buddhist. There's nothing like that. he's like a pragmatist. And that's what I like. There's no dogmatism. No baggage, no dogmatism. And nobody trying to tell, hardly anyone, trying to tell me how I should view Longchenpo, you know, right? Which is very nice. So, the goal is abidance, and we have this practice, full stop in the wow, and it's just as good as any other practice. It's top-notch practice. It doesn't have the Vajrayana visualization, mantra, and meditation phases, that kind of thing, and visualization, the generation and completion stage, and, you know, all the tantra of purifying perception, which Padmasambhava gave out, which is really Tibetan Buddhism. They call Padmasambhava the second Buddha because Buddha gave out the sutras, which is a gradualist approach, pretty much. You'd say, you know, your habits, working on your life and your habits and your mind and all this stuff. Whereas Padmasambhava gave out the tantra, which is really directly involved with purifying our perception. And dharma means kind of protecting us from falling into ordinary perception. And interestingly enough, A Course in Miracles is exactly that same. A Course in Miracles is actually, I wouldn't say it's more advanced, I'd say it's clearer and fresher. It hasn't gone through 2,500 years of interpretation and schisms and different sects and all sorts of different stuff arising and interpretations. It's very fresh and very clear, and it aims at purifying our perception. And abidance is how we keep ourselves from falling back into ordinary perception. Dualistic perception. So it's all at the mountaintop. It's all the same, you see. But I've never done Vajrayana Buddhism. I've never visualized. I've never done mantras. I've never done type of formal meditation of nothing like that. But I have done this full stop in the wow practice, which is actually, you could say it's in that echelon of the highest practice type of echelon. I think Talopa, the great Mahasiddha, gave this teaching out. Very similar teaching, actually. It's a fundamentally great practice to have. Full stop in the wow. very fresh, a fresh presentation of it. And so it has propelled me into to a very good position, or a quite extraordinary position of you know, it's like teachers, a general want good lieutenants, right? You might say, the general's looking for good lieutenants. And so the Longchenpa says, hey, you know, you'd make a really good lieutenant. You know, would you please be one of my lieutenants? So I say, absolutely. Where do I sign up? Today I enlisted because there's this great weirdness coming upon the world, I think is the best way to describe it. Okay, let's just say that. I think this is a very good term to use. And that sort of encapsulates it all. A very great weirdness is going to come upon the world. And Longchenpa, along with the whole canon and array of Tibetan Buddhism, which is one of the most successful and amazing traditions in the history of the planet, is, you know, all in combating this weirdness. They are really trained as bodhisattvas, which mean they put our welfare first ahead of their own. And their aim is to enlighten, bring everyone into pure, clear perception, abidance in the clear light, true perception. And so they're very trained in the spiritual altruism and protecting the Dharma. They're great Dharma protectors. They really, so they're just like naturals for this situation in the world, this weirdness that's coming up. They're all in. You know, it's a brigade. It's a strong, strong brigade, to say the least. And so we absolutely adore this and applaud it, welcome it and accept it. And it doesn't conflict with any other of the strong brigades either. It's sort of like there's this, you know, alliance right now to fend off this weirdness that is being engineered in this world. So full stop in the wow is a great practice, and I've been very successful with it. I'm very good at it. I've been doing it for a long time, and I had to use it today on a number of occasions. In fact, all day. The intensity right now, and the synchronicity right now, and the breakthroughs right now are have increased. As we entered this period, starting April 26, I was right on the money with this. It was absolutely amazing what happened. And some long-term goals were suddenly reached this morning. Boom, boom, I got on the scale. I hit the weight I've been aiming for so long, I just couldn't reach it. And suddenly there was. I was absolutely shocked. I don't know how it happened. And then I went out and I was exercising and trying to keep my good habits going. And I was swinging a golf club, and suddenly it wasn't working good, and I started tweaking some parameters and not giving up, and suddenly, boom, the swing was just there. It was just easy, repeatable, hits the pure spot every time. It's just like, wow, that's it. I was shocked. I was stunned. So I sort of had a double stunning this morning of reaching some very long-term goals. And then during the day, some tremendous insights have been arising. So, and I had to practice full stop in the wow. And this is the key technique. So what we're going to do is there's this technicality about this which will help out if I, you know, provided I can get to this and explain it. Is, okay, what it is, it is full stop in the wow has to account for our concern that there may be a delayed reaction. So we get the glimpse and we say, ah, that's it, I see it now. And they say, okay, now how am I functioning? And you kind of look and you see, oh, everything's okay. I'm still eating my macaroni salad and drinking my water and sitting here in the kitchen, and everything is fine. And then you think, okay, but that's not full stop in the wow. Okay. So this is why this is such a profound practice, as we take the extra step. It's all about taking this extra step and saying, you know what? This was such a profound insight. It rocked my spiritual landscape. I have to take precautions in case there's a fear of a delayed reaction within me, which is going to bite me. And I've so let me stay very patient here and not declare victory yet at all. So we do not declare victory. In other words, saying, you know what? I got it. This is the insight and no trouble, all this stuff. We refuse to declare victory like that. As I've said before, go in order to speed up, go slower. Refuse to declare victories because it's likely there's a delayed, we at least we fear a delayed reaction. This is lurking there. It's like they hidden. It's the iceberg underneath the. We see a tip of the iceberg. We say, "Oh, okay, great. Now I see what's going on." No, there's a whole iceberg beneath the ocean, the hidden part. And so we are not tricked by this. Okay, here. Now, here is the technicality that is we need to look at. And what we do is we do not go back and revisit the insight. We refuse to revisit the insight. We say, no, I got it right the first time. It was crystal clear to me. I know it's right. So we refuse to go back to it. This is the whole key, really, the essence of full stop and wow. You refuse to go back to the insight. Refuse. Why? Why? Here is why. This nagging fear that there's going to be a delayed reaction to our insight. Panic, some sort of panic mode, delayed reaction. When we go back and say, whoa, let me go back to this insight, what we nominally, superficially say is, well, I want to reinforce it. But actually what I just saw tonight and discovered and saw very clearly is actually we want to modify it. In case there's a delayed reaction, we want to go back and modify it so it's not so clear. So that it might ease a potential delayed reaction. So what we want to do is have faith that no, this clarity was clear the first time. It needs no modification, and I am going to deal with whatever reaction there is without trying to modify what I saw at all. This is the heart of it right here. The heart of success. And it's not, it's easy, and yet if the will isn't there, it's not easy. The faith, if the faith's not there, it's not easy. But for me, I can do it. And you will feel this, sometimes you feel a burn within you, sort of, and jitteriness, and saying, oh my gosh, if only I could go back and remember what that insight was. No, don't get tricked by that. What we're really saying is, if only I could go back and modify that, maybe I could avoid what I feel might be this, the jitters coming up or something. Refuse to go back and revisit it. Refuse. You got it the first time. It's done deal. It's done deal. And you might not even know what the insight was. Don't try to remember what it was. The battle is to not go back and try to remember what it was. This is the battle. And so you feel like, whoa, how extraordinary. I'm in this state of almost shock, and yet I don't even know why. Refuse to try to think about what was it. Now, what was it that I, you know, what? So this is the whole discipline of this practice and why it's such a profound practice. And I'm feeling it right now. I am a little jittery because I know I saw something absolutely terrific. In fact, many, many times today, I had essential breakthroughs that are just so important in concerning abidance. And yet, I can't tell you what they were because I refuse to revisit them because I know I'm still in the wow. At some point, when this wow reaction wear and the jitters wear off, then it'll be easy, real easy. You say, oh, yeah, I've already got that. I'm familiar with that. But not now. So, when they first arise, these big breakthroughs, and you're so far along that these breakthroughs are certain to arise as you. As you refuse to panic and revisit them and try to modify them, then as you get used to it, familiar, and the wow sort of smooths out, for sure, insights will arise just automatically. It's automatic. It's automatic. It's a done deal. You have to just be determined to accept the fact that you got it, and don't revisit it when the wow is there. Don't revisit it. Then you can trust in yourself, and these insights will arise, and your team leader, however you want to call it, will help these insights arise and resolve all these very tricky problems. And you will see, oh, there's something I've been struggling with my entire life. For instance, the reactions of others, and I struggle with the same thing. What are they going to say? All this. You see a resolution to that. Oh my gosh, I've been struggling my entire life, and now I see it. Okay, you see it? That's it. You've seen it. Now, full stop on the wow. Don't go back and revisit it. Have faith that your seeing was pure, was true, and the teacher is in charge of bringing these insights to your attention. They know how to liberate you and how to work past the resistance. And so your job is to refuse to try to go back and modify the insight that you already had. And so the desire to go back and modify is so strong, and you don't do it, you might feel these jitters arising. Shaking and trembling because you're not allowing yourself to go back and but it's fine. You just, as you refuse to do this, you get the jitters, and the jitters will gradually wear off. Very intense, but also one of the fastest paths there is, for sure. It's in that upper echelon, top echelon of super fast. And when you're in the top echelon, you don't draw comparisons at all. You refuse to draw any comparisons. Well, something's top echelon, it's top echelon, and that's all there is to it. Don't even go back and try to write it down. Don't try to express it in thoughts or words or anything. You just play dumb for a while. I've got the jitters, and I'll just be with that. I walk into the store today, and all the employees, they're all wearing these bright red shirts. They all got handed out this that morning, I guess. And I said, wow, that's very interesting. Yeah, the synchronicities are just mind-blowing. Which is good. And yet, don't go back and revisit too much here. You know you've had them. Trust in it. Trust in your insight. Trust in your insight. Do not go back and try to modify. As soon as we try to remember, we're actually trying to modify it. Now, I can say today was just vastly rich in clarity. And yet right now, I can't tell you what happened. But that just shows how vastly rich it was. That I'm so much in this wow reaction. That says it right there. Some people are having children right now. I talked to a friend of mine that just had a baby, and he says, I said it probably helps you because you're so focused on that. Your whole world's just that baby and trying to, feed the baby and, respond to its crying and everything. And he said, yeah. I mean, I've forgotten everything else, and I'm not really following the news or this or that or sports or anything. And I said, that's really interesting because I'm not following any of that either. I have a different focus here, but it's similar that you have like just a singular focus. And for him, it's his new baby, and for me, it's this abidance here. Now. How serious is this weirdness? Well, I dropped habits, lifetime habits, that I just dropped them cold turkey, like watching golf. I've I've watched golf like almost every weekend for like 40 years. I enjoy it. It's very relaxing. It's peaceful. You see such beautiful surroundings, and so calm and peaceful and civilized. It's so nice. But I have no idea what's going on with golf right now. I completely stopped it. Totally stopped it. Same with baseball. Always followed baseball my whole life. Completely stopped it. Completely stopped all these interests that I had. Cold turkey, just dropped them all. This is how important reaching abundance is. And we will reach it. And the way is to when these insights arise, don't try to revisit them. Now, whatever happens in the future, whatever labels we want to put upon it, a bee has just arrived, interesting. It all adds up to extreme weirdness. However you want to slice that pizza, however we slice a pizza, it's still just it's the pizza there. You get all these weird toppings on it, it's a weird pizza. That I'd say this is just the way to bottom line the whole thing and be done with it. It's just going to be very intense weirdness going forward now. Going forward. For the foreseeable future is just going to be this very intense weirdness. And so how do you prepare for very intense weirdness? This is the question. I could say no matter what avenue people take and to try to get familiar with anything worldly, it won't work. It's the weirdness, it will unseat it all. And so we want to be in the seatless seat. And ultimately, that is that reality has no script. It's scriptless. It's free of all script. That's the ultimate flipping of the script, is there is no script. So it's the seatless seat. We're abiding in the seatless seat. And the weirdness cannot get to that, actually. No matter what form the weirdness takes. And we're not going to try and examine the weirdness. It's just weirdness. Okay, is it all right, fine. We're trying to weird ourselves out, but we're in the seatless seat. And where is that? It's seatless seat. Now, here is another treasure that is came to light today. I can discuss, maybe I'll bring up a little bit. We'll see how it goes. There's this Buddhism is sort of based on, I believe the four, was it the Four Noble Truths of Buddha is something along the lines. He gets into, that we're all suffering, and he talks about, he's trying to say, look, accept the fact that we're really suffering and it's miserable and this impermanence. And he talks about determinate arising, or dependent arising of that everything is. Nothing is a thing in itself. Everything is dependent on everything else. And then Nagarjuna, he was actually named Arjuna. And he went down to southern India, and supposedly a Naga gave him out of the sea, the great sea, Deva of the sea, Deva of the sea. A Naga gave him this book, was essential teachings. And so he changed the name to Nagarjuna, Nagarjuna. Arjuna, he said Arjuna, Nagarjuna, to honor the Naga influence with him. And he's very big on this determinate arising and explaining this. Well, that nothing is permanent at all. Buddha said, there's only in this impermanence. Well, today I saw it differently. I see it differently. There's a way to see it differently. For me, this is extraordinary flipping the script here, okay? And I'll say it. For me, everything is permanent. It's all permanent. Everything is eternal life. And A Course in Miracles actually helps us get to this perspective. And so we don't need to, right now, maybe dig into it. Just hear that and just say, wow, this is a really different way. Everything we see is actually eternal life. There's nothing that's impermanent at all. And there's no dependent arising whatsoever. So this is more like a Longchenpa type of teaching, really. No, I saw, you know, why this is. I see it, but I don't want to quite explain it at this moment because it's kind of, you know, I've got to see what the shock waves are, because this is something that stands everything on its head. Like Buddhism just flips the whole script in a certain way. This is a fundamental tenet of most Buddhism. But again, Longchenpa, he's not exactly a Buddhist, really. Zogchen, and especially the radical Zogchen, the Adi Yoga, it's something that is, it doesn't quite fit in the canon of Buddhism, does it? Not exactly. And so, this is like saying, for a Christian to say that Jesus didn't suffer on the cross or something, which he didn't, actually. They say, what? But Jesus didn't die for your sins. I mean, some central tenets, you know, saying this is not true. To say that there isn't this determinate arising and there's no such thing as impermanence is, you know, to say the central tenets of Buddhism aren't necessarily the highest way of looking at the situation. There's another way to look at it. To our perception, it seems this way, of course. But of course, our perception is faulty. So from clear perception, I believe, you see that everything is absolutely permanent. Everything is already existing eternally. Now, the fact that we may play games of symbolizing things, like symbolizing a tree exists as an idea, as a permanent eternal idea. And this is sort of what Plato was getting at, wasn't he? Which, by the way, Plato sort of arose at the same time as Buddha. There's all these teachings that arose pretty similar. Jainism, Zoroastrianism, Buddhism, Plato, I don't know, Platonism, I don't know what you call it, Platoism, you don't say Platoism, but something like that. Right around like the 6th century BC, there were all these, you know, philosophical religious belief systems that arose at that time, and then Mahadeva came along and sort of split things into, you know, Theravada and Mahayana and Theravada Buddhism, which basically said that the arhants, you know, weren't really these divine beings and that they shouldn't be seen that way, and modified some of the rules and such and made it more kind of a people power sort of thing. And then most Buddhists, that became then the Mahayana Buddhism. And then they did a marketing campaign calling Theravada Hinayana, which kind of means, it's kind of a derogative term, actually. And there was a schism in Buddhism. There's a big schism, actually, really big schism, similar to the, you know, the Nestorian duophysitism as versus monophysitism. Was Jesus both divine and human, or just divine, or just human? And it was a one nature, two natures. And the Council of Chalcedon, Chalcedonian Council, was it 483 AD or something like that? Ultimately, they said, let's call it, you know, dualistic. He's both human and divine, fully human and fully divine. and then excommunicated those who didn't accept this. So there's a huge schism there, and then later there's a schism between the Eastern Orthodox and Rome, which has been in, still to this day is just they. I don't know if they've just recently maybe talked to each other the first time in 1,500 years or something. I mean, or however long, 1,000 years. I mean, these schisms happen, and they keep elements in common, but there's they disagree on certain, you know, picky stuff that they, you know, should just say, hey, you know, let's stop being so trivial and quibble over all this stuff, and let's just realize that we're, you know, the goal is the same for all of us here. But, you know, it doesn't quite work that way, because the elites, the people, the idea of Buddhism started out, the Arhants, those who were enlightened, listened to Buddha, they were seen as, you know, elite gurus, and people respected them, treated them like they were divine. And then, of course, a populace comes along, like Mahadeva, and says, hey, you know, they're not that divine, you know. They got doubts, and you don't, and people power and populist people say, oh yeah, and you know, that's what happens. But I would say great respect should be given to those who are enlightened. A tremendous respect should be given to them, because we should say, I want to be like that too. This is my ideal, you know. This is like something ideal, really ideal. I want to be like that too. So certainly there should be this enormous respect. I mean, this is how I've lived. I've always had this enormous respect for all the saints, all the enlightened beings, and clearly put them above myself. You know, just say, you know, they're way up there, and I'm way down here, and that's just how it is. And use them as role models. You know, really, really. So if you're going to use a role model, don't quibble about it. It's just pragmatism, I think. It's stupid to nitpick at role models. Really stupid. So I try to stay away from that. It's counterproductive. Really, it is. It doesn't matter if they have some doubts. If someone's a role model, just use them that way. It's a pragmatic, something pragmatic. And of course, we might know that they may not be, you know, as perfect as you might see them or something. But that's not the point. The point is, are they helpful? Is having this role model helpful? That's what's important. Because it's about our awakening, actually. Not about theirs. It's about our awakening. So we try not to criticize these various role models too much. And if I have in the past, I have to apologize and say, you know, maybe a few deserved it. But even then, some people might say, well, I'm using them as a role model, and it's helpful in that regard. So that's, I understand that. That's very positive. However you can get some really, feel really great role model, this is very important. Very, very important. So people power is not necessarily such a great thing. I mean, they had a point, but that can be taken too far. So there's kind of, you have to strike a balance between, it's like strike a balance between Mahayana and Theravada. Strike this kind of accord and balance to say, okay, it's both are, they actually are one body, right? And there's just sort of the attempt to kind of have a balance between, you know, this idealization and of those who are enlightened, using them as role models, and also people feeling that, of course, that they can do it too, which of course they can, but they're not going to do it very easily if they don't have role models. That's for sure. And so most people kind of feel this ecumenicalness about this and understand this. Same with Christianity, same with all these traditions. There's always this sort of tug of war taking place, some friction. Same with Tibetan Buddhism. I think that the Gelugpa are not part of the Rime movement, which is, you know, the Nyingma, Sakya, and Kagyu are part of the Rime movement, which is kind of ecumenical. It's a very strong ecumenical movement, because the Gelugpas became a political power and basically persecuted Nyingma or Dzogchen, and lorded it over the others. And even now, they don't join the Rime movement because they're the most powerful group. The Dalai Lama is part of that group, but he's quite ecumenical, actually, and he's trying to reach out and kind of, rebuild these bridges. So as we become more mature, we kind of start, we kind of become very ecumenical. All this stuff doesn't bother us. We become pragmatists here. Pragmatists, and not lose sight of just the pragmatism of it all. The seatless seat, the everless victory, the weirdness that we're faced with, as if existence wasn't weird enough, this nightmare, it can get weirder, actually. It can really try to outweird itself. That's its defense. So it's getting very defensive right now. It's going to get very defensive. So the at the top echelons, they're ecumenical, and Longchenpa, he didn't come to me and say, oh, I'm a Buddhist or something, or I'm a Dzogchenist, or he just said, look, this is the nature of mind, the sky-like nature of mind. This is intrinsic spaciousness. This is reality. That's all. And keep practicing to get to reality. Rama Maharshi told me the practice that you're doing is really great. And he said it's going to work and it's going to get you there. So don't stop doing it. He says, don't practice what I would advise or what I was doing. Just stick with what you're doing. It's working great. So totally ecumenical, actually. Ramana was very ecumenical. People say he said only said inquire, do this, but they're kind of trying to be too dogmatic. Actually, he said that he gave that out to people because most people that would help them, but he said he gave other teachings out to other people. It just depends. He said it all depends on where they're at, actually. Very ecumenical. Top teachers are very ecumenical, actually. It's their followers who are not so ecumenical. And get very dogmatic and righteous about stuff. So, everything is permanent. How about that? There's no dependent arising at all. This is an assertion we can make. And this, you can just feel the wow. I feel the wow just hitting hard, the wow. This goes against the current, goes against the grain to an extreme extent. Now, I read something, it might have been by the Dalai Lama explaining this, but he was saying that something like everything is both permanent and impermanent. There's permanence and impermanence. Emptiness and non-emptiness. In other words, he's saying, don't get trapped in the explanations. Don't get trapped in the explanations. People have sort of misinterpreted. It's not just the West that's misinterpreted. Teachings always get misinterpreted. People misinterpreted Tantra, but there's several different. There's Indian Tantra, and there's Padmasambhava Tantra, Vajrayana Tantra. It's not the same, really. The Mahasiddha Saraha in Bengal gave rise to this populist movement of Tantra, which was, evolved what the West views Tantra. And embracing, the body and the flesh and ordinary life and the passions and all this kind of stuff and drug use, just all that kind of stuff. That's not Padmasambhava's tantra at all. His was to purify perception through this deity visualization, through mantras and mandalas and meditation, visualization. And it's very, very esoteric type of practice. It was designed to purify our perception. And the Dalai Lama said that when you mix emptiness with compassion, this is what Vajra, Jnana Buddhism is all about, actually. Mixing compassion, emptiness, and compassion. I think this is a very, very, very good take on it. I like that. And then from that, you visualize a deity which just represents the purity of your perception. It's sort of a representation of the purity of your perception. So I don't question that they know what they're doing. I don't question that at all. But this, not the visualization and this kind of stuff, it's not the only way. This full stop in the wow is also, as Ramana said, this is a very good way. Very, very good way. And Longchenpa hasn't suggested any change to it, or like, oh, stop doing this. You need to, you know, do Vajrayana Buddhism or something. No, nothing like that. This works. I mean, did you just get direct perception reality and then full stop in the wow? Because you think there might be some delayed reaction that I'm not accounting for. I don't know what it would be, but it might be, you know, hidden somewhere. I'm not really sure. There's this. So we have to refuse to go back and act on this fear and try to modify our pure perception. I mean, we keep getting glimpses of pure perception. This is what's happening. You say, oh, I see this now. Oh, I just saw it. That's pure perception. We keep getting more and more glimpses of pure perception. And I saw that everything is eternal, actually. Absolutely, because everything's an idea in the mind of God, actually. Like Plato said, there's a realm of these ideas. And ideas are eternal. Jesus, in Course in Miracles, tells us ideas are eternal. They never vanish. They're always there. Now, we perceptually, we say, well, they're unmanifest, because perceptually we may not see it. We only see things that we call manifest to our perception. But perception, Jesus tells us, is actually part of the dream of separation. So when we say, well, I perceive an determinate, impermanent arising, well, with what? What are we perceiving it with? Perception? Well, that's false. That's the play of belief in separation right there. In reality, it's knowing these ideas of everything, all ideas, all possibilities are ideas, and they're eternal. So we're seeing symbolizations, as it were, of eternal ideas, representations of eternal ideas, and even those representations are eternal as well, because representation is also an idea. So there's no impermanence, actually. This is what I'm suggesting. There's no impermanence whatsoever. And this may throw again the Hindus and the Buddhists and all the various, like, wow, you flipped upside down or something. Or maybe they might say, wow, let me just, you know, meditate on that. Let me just... Now, this fits in with Jesus. It teaches us a lot. Very beautifully. Now, like the doctors, they may all get along, and the nurses will say, oh, the doctor told me this, and some other nurses will say, no, my doctor told me this, and the nurses are getting all these squabbles, like, well, they told me to do this, but the doctors, they look at each other and say, no, they, I just had to tell them in a certain way they'd understand, but the doctors aren't fighting with each other. You know, they said, we know what the patient needs, and we may give different prescriptions for the different patients, and we told the nurse, give this prescription to this patient because it works. And so the nurse says, no. And we'll say, this is what the doctor tells works or to cure this problem, and this is the answer. And the doctor will tell some other nurse for some other patient, well, you know, that medicine isn't going to work so good for that patient, so there's this other medicine that also works, so I want you to give them this medicine. And the nurse says, aha, now this is the medicine that is going to cure the patient. And then the two nurses meet and say, what do you got, a patient? Yeah, I got a patient that has this problem. Oh, mine has the same problem. So what are you doing? You're giving him this? And the nurse says, no, I'm giving him this medicine. And the other nurse says, whoa, wait a minute. My doctor told me that this medicine's the right one. How could your doctor be telling that your doctor's wrong? And the other nurse says, no, my doctor's not wrong. My patient's getting well. And then the nurses have got a conflict in here, just saying, wait a minute. And the doctor's, my doctor's right, yours wrong. I can't trust this other doctor. The doctors aren't having this squabble. They realize that there's different skillful means depending on the uniqueness of the patient. So this is kind of the way it is here. The nurses are the ones fighting. We got to get up into doctor mode here. And the patients too. The patient says, I'm taking this medicine. That's what does it. I don't want to hear about this other medication. That won't work for me. We have all tried, and we're trying to purchase our freedom from freedom. And we all have tried all this very clever complexity that differs. The idea of all this so-called difference, all this complexity, is that we're trying to find what works. And so inherently, the attempt to do the impossible goes into this massive complexity of uniqueness, each one seeming to have a different type, different aspect of complexity, so they can say, well, that doesn't work over there, but that's okay, I've got a different outlook, different complexity, so I feel this is going to work. This is how we keep our hope alive, is through this complexity and uniqueness, thinking that, well, it's not working for them, but I have something different, so it might work for me, like this. And so to treat this problem, you can't give exactly the same prescription to everybody. It has to be a little bit different, because they say, well, wait a minute, I'm unique. They're using this way, but I know I'm unique, and so that's not really going to work for me. You have this issue. So the Holy Spirit, through the grace of the various teachers, helps us along our path. And then some groupings work, some skillful means work for a large group, and others work for another large group, because there's a lot of similarities. So full stop in the wow is a way that works, and others may not, want to do that. Maybe some see this, impermanent dependent arising, that help works for them. For me, I see everything as eternal life. No dependent arising at all. Everything's just the light directly, light giving rise to all this directly, actually. It's all direct. There's no dependent arising whatsoever. It's all immediate and direct. Right now, this instant. It's a hologram. And the idea of process of dependent arising is all an illusion, perceptual illusion. That's Maya. Or Mara trying to defeat Buddha out of the Bodhi tree, trying to deceive Buddha into thinking a certain way. Like there's some sort of process taking place. There's no process. It's all this right here, right now. Light is presenting this instant. Everything is just light. The light of God presenting all this appearance, because we want to dance with this appearance. That's I cannot get this thing. That's all there is, and so it's always right now. It's always right now. It's always right now. It's always the light is right now. It's always in the now. And everything is this eternal light, this permanent eternal light, and it's expressing ideas in the mind of God. Really. And these ideas are eternal. Everything we can imagine is eternal, actually. There's only eternal life. There's no non-eternal life at all. It doesn't exist. And everything is eternal life. Non-eternal life never arises at all in any way. Now, as we have these great, amazing insights, keep up the good habits, which is what I'm trying to do. The various boycotts, the various dropping this and dropping that and saying, I got to really focus in right now. Just keep that going. And for example, keep for me exercise. I did jump rope today. I don't know how many, maybe 250 or, you know, pretty good jump rope. Wasn't excessive. Did a lot of ab work, which is always tough, and did some stretching and flexibility and some upper body strengthening work, and so I got in like just a decent workout. Even though I felt super tired and just, wow, I don't even know if I can even function, just say, well, I got to keep at least maintenance, and keep myself from slipping. And this is just a discipline of will. When you're in an intensive, the idea of an intensive is that you're under a lot of pressure, and that but you've decided you're going to keep your good habits in spite of the pressure. So this is, see, this, the intensive is really coming from the upcoming weirdness in the world, and people are feeling the intensity of that actually. So what we're doing with this intensive is just being determined to continue our good habits, and always just to be determined. I'm not listening to music now. I'm not doing anything except trying to just consider the truth here. In various ways, and keeping up just basic good habits of eating and exercise. Don't go astray. Don't fall back into comfortable habits that might comfort us. You know, security blanket of, oh yeah, I'm so used to this habit. Maybe this intensity, I can take refuge in that. Well, no. The old habits that we have will not be sufficient for the purposes of refuge. That's why when this dream, I had this terrible storm coming, and I took refuge under this huge tree, massive tree. And it symbolized like all the historic efforts that we have done all, you know, thousands of years. And the storm still got through that tree, and I was realized I'm going to be drenched, and that's it. I'm going to suffer horribly. And at that point, this black and white tabletop was put over me, with legs on it. A black and white granite tabletop was suddenly, someone placed it there. I don't know where it came from. And the rain could not get through that, and I was kept dry. I huddled underneath that, and I was kept dry. Kind of like I'm huddling under this red blanket, which doesn't quite wrap around me, but you know, it's spiritual protection. Spiritual protection. You huddle under black and white, cut and dried. This is just how it is. So that's why I wear black and white clothing now, with a touch of red. Actually, red is the color of spiritual protection. In Tibetan Buddhism, it means spiritual protection, which is really Dharma, which is really protecting our healed perception. Of course, Miracles calls it healed perception, and they might call it pure perception. Tibetan Buddhism, like pure perception, divine perception, pure perception. Jesus calls it healed perception. It's the same thing. It's protecting our healed perception, our pure perception. That's what Dharma really is, means. And the Dharma King is someone who's expert in protecting our pure perception. Which is really abidance in the seatless seat, which we get by getting more and more glimpses of pure perception and not trying to go back and revise what we saw, no matter what quote-unquote our good intentions may seem to be. Full stop in the wow. I'm not either advancing or retreating right now. And just be glued to that. Have faith, and then tomorrow you find out, wow, I'm having even better insights now. This is what happens. I can testify to this. Get better and better and better insights. I kind of, with this red, though, I wrapped myself up in this red. I look like a Bodhidharma doll or something, who brought, you know, Chan Buddhism to Japan, where it was called Zen Buddhism, which is a sudden awakening school, Mahayana type of teaching. They have these little red dolls that you push them over and they roll right back up upright. You know, it's like when you're, in other words, full stop in the wow. When you the mind tries to go straight to the side, you bring it right back. Bring it right back. This is the essence of it all, of the practice and Buddhism, whatever you want to call it, is don't let your mind stray. Don't go back and revise clarity. When you get glimpses of clarity, don't go back and try to revise it conceptually or thinking about it. Okay, let me bring that up and study it. No. It's like a lightning bolt. Don't try to reenact a lightning bolt. You can might call this lightning bolt meditation. We do that. It's that these glimpses of pure perception are like lightning bolts striking nearby. And we just sit calmly and quietly and say, okay, a lightning bolt just struck nearby. Great. Lit up the whole sky. Wonderful. I'm not going to try and later say, okay, now what happened? Now where did the lightning bolt strike? Now, and try to visualize and think about it and all this. No, don't do that. Don't do any visualization. Don't do any mantra. Don't do any mandala, recitation. Don't do any meditation. Just full stop. Don't advance or retreat. Don't practice. Don't try. Don't struggle. Don't strive. This is Longchenpa's advice, actually. A great Dharma king, a protector of pure perception. He knows how to protect pure perception, which ultimately is all we have to learn that too, how to do that. When we are skillful at protecting pure perception, guess what? We will be abiding in pure perception. That's the outcome. That is the outcome. And I've been working on this for quite some time now, but very directly for probably like, I don't know, it's like 2.5 years or so, where I got the glimpse of pure spaciousness, intrinsic spaciousness, and a little bit after that, I was able to get into abidance, and then I saw myself coming out of it and say, okay, wow. Maybe even 3 years, but we're having these experiences of really abidance, and then seeing, okay, I'm coming out of it. Wow, what's going on? And recognizing the tricks that we get tricked out of it. Wow, just seeing it. Okay, saw that. Don't do anything about it. Seeing it is powerful. Silence, as Ramana said, silence is more powerful, always more powerful than speech. This is also what he's getting at. Don't go back and mentally talk about it, think about it. Don't talk yourself out of it. No matter how altruistic the excuse that we give ourselves, oh, no, I want to reinforce it. Don't do it. As in the Bible says, don't look back, right? You get turned into a pillar of stone if you look back. This is another way of putting it. Judaism and Old Testament and Judeo-Christianity, that's a wisdom tradition too. Don't look back. They've tried to, those who are engineering all this weirdness have tried to knock out Christianity, and been trying to do that for a long time. So they think they've got it all covered. Right, because they've done a pretty good job, to say the least. I mean, people are simply not ready for weirdness. They are ready to embrace a new world religion, maybe revised Catholicism or something. Yeah, but that's not going to protect their minds, the Dharma, pure perception at all. Remember, Dharma is protecting pure perception, so you don't fall into ordinary, normal, demented perception, absurdity, absurdist perception, dualistic perception. Well, what's going on in teaching now in the mainstream Catholicism, Christianity, that doesn't protect pure perception, really. It's not really skillful that way. It's basically saying, well, ordinary perception's fine as long as you do charity work. That's no problem. It's fine. That's the goal anyway. That's ridiculous what they're saying. They those who've engineered this weirdness and believe that we're all going to have a meltdown, they really didn't account for Longchenpa. Did they? Now, some people call Ajahn the second Buddha. Some call the third Buddha. I mean, some call Padmasambhava the second Buddha. He brought the Vajrayana teachings, diamond or thunderbolt clarity teachings. Diamond clarity teachings, a very fast, very direct way for those of very acute mind to reach pure perception. They call him the second Buddha, giving out the Vajra and Buddha, the Sutra teachings, Sutrayana, Vajrayana, different approaches depending on who you're speaking to. And Longchenpa was supposedly the culmination of Padmasambhava's teaching, that he got it and put it all together. So he's in this echelon there, like you call him the second or Buddha or third Buddha or really another Buddha. Really, he's in that echelon. It's right there. With Shakya Muni or Gautama Buddha, however you want to call him, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa. They're all, you know, right there. With the Vajrasattva, you know, clarity. Yeah. And diamond mind, clear light mind, the mind, the diamond that can't be cut by anything, right? Diamond cuts everything, but is not cut by anything. Our mind gives rise to all this, but is not touched by any of it. This magical illusion, this play of imagination and form and all this is just, this is symbolic. It's all symbols, as Jesus says, actually. Everything is just eternal. This tree right there is eternal. It's not really impermanent. That's just an illusion. Because it's light. Is light impermanent? Well, cannot light project this tree exactly as we're seeing it eternally? Absolutely light can. It's always there to be projected. The idea. Everything, all potentiality exists eternally. And so it's real right now, actually. Doesn't have to be projected for us to say it's real. So the full stop in the wow is the practice, and it's like the temptation arises. Speaking of temptation, the temptation arises to, oh, I just got to go back to that insight. That was such a great insight. It's the best ever. I just got to. No, that's the temptation. Don't fall for that temptation. That's the snake in the Adam and Eve allegory, so to speak. You could look at it that way, is a temptation. You go into conceptuality, the snake of conceptuality, the snake of, right, of revisionism, the snake, it's a symbol of how the snake can kind of get all tangled up, right, seem to be all tangled up. Mind can get all tangled up when it tries to conceptualize and revisit clarity. So what was that again? Try to remember it. No, don't do that. That's the snake. So the Advaita Vedanta, you know, the coiled rope, or is it a coiled rope or snake? Well, when you try to go back and revisit the fact that you saw it as coiled rope, well, then you see the snake there. And then you say, whoa, wait a minute, maybe I was wrong. You see how we trick ourselves and freak ourselves out. We see it very clearly. Oh, it's just rope. I see that. No problem. Wow. That's the end of the whole rope snake problem, isn't it? Yeah, it is. It's finished. Okay. Wow. Wow. Full stop in the wow. And if you try to go back, say, oh, wait a minute, I just had the greatest insight ever. I'm liberated. Whoa, what was it? Let me think. I started forgetting. Let me go back, and then you start struggling to remember it. Well, as soon as you do that, suddenly your perception shows you, a snake, because that's the snake of your writhing, struggling mind. Right? It's a symbol for struggling mind, contrasting absurdities and contrasting this and conceptuality. It's all entangled. And now you say, oh my gosh, it was a snake. I thought it was a rope. I thought I saw clearly it was a rope, but now I see it actually was a snake. Well, what was I thinking when I saw it was a rope? I must have been deluded. And so you end up then believing that clarity is delusion. And that's the problem that we're entrapped in, is the belief that clarity is delusion. It's not. But when we try to revisit it, the snake seems to arise. So, Adam and Eve, another way of looking at the thing is that I like this way of looking at it even better than what I was going to say. So maybe I won't even say the other. But let's put it this way, that we're responsible for our experiencing, and no one's responsible. We don't get it from our parents genetically or this or that. We're experiencing the result of our habits, our mental habits, and our mental habits, we have to get free of those. So it's original sin, you don't get passed down like this. It's our own karma that we have. I'm 100% sure of this. Awakening to my previous lives, I was able to see that everything I have now is a result of my previous lives, and my parents didn't give me any of these troubles. They're my troubles. I gave them to myself, my own snake-like thinking of confusion, of trying to, you know, revisit clarity as if you're coming from some other place other than that. Yeah, so it's all our own fault, the suffering we're having. It's nobody else's fault, really. But which is a great thing, which means we don't have to depend on someone else to heal it, you know, free us from it necessarily. We accept the guru is ourself. Okay, the guru is absolutely not other than ourself. It's not other than ourself, so we're getting direct help from ourself in that way. But we're not dependent on anyone that we see as, you know, different than us or other than us to help us out. Nobody did anything to us. It's our own karma, the mental habits of attention that are the issue, the mental excuses that we make. So don't revisit what has been said here. Don't revisit it. And this trains you to be in the now. Say, I'm not going to revisit. Whatever comes up, I won't revisit it. This helps train us to get it right now. Because how can we revisit where we already are? That immediately throws us into duality. If we just see, I'm here. I'm sitting in the seatless seat. I am it. 360 degree effortless victoryism, perfect poise. It's not I am seeing this, I am this. I am. It's really I am-ness. It's just that, I am-ness. How can we revisit I am-ness? From where? So we got to stop revisiting ourselves, you know? No visitors allowed. I can't visit myself, really, no. I am. Wow, we've done well here. I am. People say, you're getting so skinny, you're getting so skinny. I met someone I hadn't seen for a while, and he looked at me and said, oh my gosh, you're so skinny. So that's how you know you really changed. It's someone you haven't seen like in 3-4 months or whatever, and they just like amazed, like, oh my gosh, you're skinny. And I say, great, that's good. I mean, I'm trying to get skinny. I want to be skinny. Now I feel that this is... will be helpful. we're going to have some really cool weather coming in, thunderstorms, and it should be really, really interesting cloud-wise and temperature-wise and just everything-wise for the next, like, maybe 5 days, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. This is unsettled weather, which is fine. It's great. I look forward to it. Something different. But the weirdness is coming in the world. This isn't just like, you know, weather, thunderstorms and stuff. No. We don't want to try and even imagine it. Let's not even worry about that. Let's just protect ourselves from it. Now, Longchenpa is on the scene because he's in the echelon of what you would say ultimate Dharma protector. He's in that echelon. You can throw Jesus in there. You can throw various, you know, names into that hat. He's in that hat. He is absolutely in that hat. And he knows the Dharma is under threat here. And so he is Johnny on the spot. He's not going to take this lying down. So, he might pull some strings, and we're enlightened. And when people ask us, "How did you do?" I said, "Well, you know, I feel like what I did was, I took a leap into enlightenment, but." At some level, I also know what happened, but I decided not to be aware of it for right now because I need to go into this action mode instead of explanation mode. So here's a little bypass that we might be able to use. Consider this. Is we wake up, we're in abidance, and people will say, "Well, how'd you do it? How'd you do this? Great, you're enlightened." Say, "Yeah, I'm enlightened." But I decided to sort of postpone the awareness of how I did it. So not right now, but maybe a little later, because I don't want to get caught up in explaining it. I'm not really here to explain it at this moment. I'm here to really, you know, be a spiritual warrior in this war. I mean, there's a war. There's actually a covert war going on in the world, and it's really intense. And the call now is not so much for explanation, but for action. Now I can explain what I've been doing here. It's fine to those who are receptive to it. That's not a problem at all. I enjoy doing it. It's those who are just dilettantes or saboteurs or just mere curiosity or just being, you know, kind of, you know, fearful and mean-spirited about it and just trying to waste your time. All, you know, there's a lot of these motivations that aren't really pure motivations and trying to trick you back into, you know, ordinary perception, ultimately, you might say, because that's where they feel comfortable. They want everybody to be that way because misery loves company. And so you just have maybe just saying, you know, I know how I did it, but I've sort of, what I did was my teacher set this aside for me in the future, so to speak, where I will be able to then visit and see how I did it. But right now, I've sort of decided to kind of not really become aware of how I did it, so I won't be tempted to get into explanation mode. See this? Where I'll be able to stay more in focused action mode. I came across this very interesting explanation of the Om Mani Padme Hum mantra, which is maybe the most popular mantra in the world. And I don't know if this is true or not, but it is certainly interesting where they say each syllable, Om Ma Ni Pad Me Om, Om Ma Ni, Om Ma Ni, Om Ma Ni Pad Me Om. It's six syllables like that. Each one of those syllables is an affirmation to protect us from the suffering in a particular realm. In Buddhism, there's six realms. There's the Devas, the, what is it? Asokas or something. Asuras, is it Asuras, the Devas, the Asuras, the human, the animal, the hungry ghost, and the hellish realms. There are six different realms. The Devas are these like almost like godlike divine beings, and the Asuras are these like warlike beings that are always jealous and fighting. Humans are those deviled by desire, and then animals are bedeviled by, you know, various sufferings. And below those are the hungry ghost realm of those who have all these, you know, cravings, you might material flesh-like cravings, And then the hellish realms are those who, with tremendous anger, apparently, something like that, where they suffer heat and cold, severe heat and cold. Don't like that. And these are the six different realms of suffering. And so Om Mani Padme Hum is, each syllable seals one of those realms. Om may seal, I'm not sure what it seals. It seals maybe the Deva realm, the Devas. The suffering of the Devas, which is that they're blinded to liberation from their own happiness. The kind of happiness that they have is sort of the indolent, beautiful, luxurious lifestyle they have is such it keeps them from ultimate liberation. So that's why they chant Om Mani Padme Hum, which they keep practicing sealing that I don't, you know, all the suffering from any of these realms, so I won't go into any of these realms. They're sealed now for me, and then I can abide in the pure land of the awakened ones, right? So that's Om Mani Padme Hum. So a lot of that has been chanted to help out the Dharma, protect the Dharma from the weirdness that this suffering of these six realms bring upon us. Now I tell you that people get possessed by these. In Christianity, you say that by these evil spirits that come from the lower, you know, hellish realms and stuff. Well, yeah. I mean, there was someone in the hospital that was definitely possessed by something. I said this, by a hungry ghost or a hellish realm, something. They said he's confused, meaning he something is possessing him. And he was just crying out in agony, like he's just being absolutely tortured. It was just amazing. He kept doing it. Oh, it wouldn't stop. So when things get really weird in this world, the realms kind of blend. And what we're having right now is sort of a blending of all six of these realms, actually. Hospital went up six floors. There's a seventh floor above, but you got to take the stairs to get there. The elevator doesn't go there. Very interesting. So we started this video out with talking about this technical detail of don't revisit, how important it is. This comes from a fear of a delayed reaction and trying to take precautionary measures against a potential delayed reaction. Okay, so let's stress this again. We fear a delayed reaction. We have this amazing breakthrough and everything seems fine. We say, what if there's a delayed reaction? And then we think, I better strengthen this insight. And then what happens is we actually weaken the insight. And then that is what brings about trouble for us. So the trouble that we're trying to protect against actually comes from preemptively trying to protect against it. Isn't that amazing? See how tricky it is? The trouble comes when we try to preemptively protect against the trouble. That's what brings the trouble. We fear delayed reaction and we think I better take steps before it happens to, you know, strengthen the insight. And by trying to strengthen the insight, we weaken it. And then that brings about this delayed reaction. So it's not really a delayed reaction. We're actually reacting to the weakened insight. Like, oh my gosh, what happened? Reality, suddenly it's not as strong or as clear as it was. It's changed. You know, and that's what brings the freak out. But we've gotten confused about it, thinking, no, that is the delayed reaction, and I just need to struggle more and revisit it more. But that just brings even worse reaction to weakening of the insight. And we spiral down. In this way, we have this beautiful insight, and then we find ourselves spiraling down. Before we know it, we're just like in this very negative mood, and just feeling, I'm freaked out. What happened? And then we start losing faith. I said, well, that wasn't it. I can't trust myself, blah, blah, blah. That's exactly what happens. So we break the cycle, this super negative cycle, which really keeps us entrapped in these six realms, if you want to look at it that way. It's what keeps us entrapped. We this full stop in the wow cuts through. It's a really Vajra Yana practice, Vajrasattvan practice, to say the least. It's the thunderbolt, the lightning bolt of cutting through this entire negative cycle that entraps us. We refuse to fall for the bait, and we say, if there's a delayed reaction, I'll just suffer it. I am not going back and revising that. And you know, when you do that, guess what? There isn't this delayed reaction. What you get is this burn of like, oh my gosh, I'm succeeding. And you get a continuity fear burn is what happens. This is the wow. You get this very intense wow reaction. Like, wow. You get the wow from the inside and you get the burn, and it builds up as you refuse to weaken your insight. Because then you realize, I am really breaking my delusory entrapment to all these six, you know, terrible realms of suffering, all suffering. I'm really getting free. And you know it, I am absolutely getting free of this. In fact, you could say it's a done deal. I am free of it. That produces its own wow. So we are seeing clearly now that we have this diamond blade. And if you know, like grinders, you know, these power tools, this wheel, and it spins around a grinder, you get the electricity going to it, it spins around real fast and just cut through stuff. Well, if you got a diamond blade on there, guess what? You can cut through steel with that and cut through anything. This is what thieves use now. They cut through your job box. They cut through all this stuff. Construction, any lock, whatever you got, doesn't matter. They got these diamond blade grinders running on battery, portable batteries, and they just go, you know, they do the diamond blade to cut right through it. And there's nothing you can do about it. That's why they have security cameras now. And the different ways to, you know, prevent this, to try to, because if you give someone with a diamond blade enough time, they'll cut through anything. So we have this like diamond blade practice here. It's really a Vajrasattvan practice, Vajrayanic practice, to say the least. We're not competing. We're colleagues, you know. We're just colleagues here with this great Vajrasattvan practice of Vajrayana, diamond vehicle practice. Refusing to revisit. No negative spiral. No negative spiral takes place. This is what I can testify from going through all of this. No more negative spirals. And what does this do? It smooths out your path. And you start going really fast. And it's smooth, fast, and smooth. No potholes. You don't hit all these potholes. It's like asphalt. New asphalt. So smooth. You don't have these ups and downs like you did before. The horrible raggedness of how it used to be, where you get these breakthroughs and insights and then you start spiraling down and get into all these mental arguments with potential inquisitors, and we just don't do that now. We don't go in this negative death spiral of trying to preemptively defend against delayed reaction, and in doing so weaken the insight, which actually then brings about a reaction that seems like, and I misinterpret that as a delayed reaction to the original clear insight. And then we say, well, I need to revisit it again, which weakens it even more, which reduces even more problems, which you think, oh my gosh, the delayed insight's even stronger than I thought, which means we go back to it again, weaken it again, and you see how it spirals down and down and down and down and down that way. All praise to the Dharma King, the protector of pure perception here, who is helping us out with this. This work we're doing is part of protecting. The clearer we get about this, the more we can share this with others, the more we protect pure perception, which is what quote-unquote Dharma is really pointing at, pure perception, protecting pure perception. Thanks to Dalai Lama, he's pretty good at clarifying stuff. I mean, I had an experience with him where I went up close to where he was, and he looked at me smiling, just burst out laughing, and just was roaring with laughter. That was all he said. Pretty amazing transmission right there, wasn't it? That's a clear light transmission. He looked at me and said, there's nothing I need to say to you. I mean, this is my transmission to you. He was talking to somebody else. He saw me. He stopped talking. He was up on a stage in San Jose. I think it was like 1989. He came to give a big empowerment in San Jose, California. I was invited to go to this by someone, and I went. And then there was this intermission, and he was up on stage talking with some of his, attendants and whatever, the big wigs or whatever. A bunch of big wigs, all right? And everybody's in their seats and, going to the bathroom or something. I got up and I just strolled down to the stage right in front, right where he was. He was just standing up above, right above me on the stage right there. And nobody else did that. It was the only one. And he was talking to some big wig, a couple of them actually. And then he stopped and he turned and looked at me. And he was just looking at me very intently. And then he just burst out laughing. Burst out laughing. Which is the reaction of an enlightened one, really. Right? When we see how it really is. It's just laughter. It's just laughter. The nature of mind, sky-like nature of mind. And just realize, mind cannot be entrapped. There's nothing to say or describe. It's just laughter. So he just burst out in laughter and was really just roaring in laughter and went on and on. I was kind of like just transfixed by it. I said, just, wow. Wow. So I have a connection with the Dalai Lama. I've always liked him. I understand he's playing a role in the world, and I don't. He's not someone that I use as a role model, but I can understand how someone uses him as a role model. That's fine. But he has a good way of kind of explaining some key concepts, really. Emptiness with compassion helps us visualize this pure perception. Emptiness and compassion together. Wow, interesting. He says, not really emptiness. It's emptiness with compassion. It's compassion and emptiness. But emptiness, he says, is not really, it's both permanence and impermanence, kind of. There's a way of looking at it. But really, you can also, I would say, even a better way is just it's all permanence. It's all permanence. Just total permanence is all there is. How about that? Just total permanence is all there is. Cut through the whole thing with a diamond blade. There's some insect that keeps jumping on my hair here. And I just, it's up there now, right now. I don't know what. Ah, come on. Crawling on my forehead. Oh my gosh. Come on. Get out of there. There it is. Okay. I'm not supposed to do that, but I said, let me liberate it from my hair. Liberate it from my hair. Supposed to keep the hands to the, don't do that. That's it. But there can be an exception. That one seemed to be really entangled in my hair. So let me get it out of my hair. Dalai Lama is pretty doggone learned. He really is. He's, a lot of effort's gone into educating him for sure. He's a lot of people like him. Maybe there's probably a reason for that. I wouldn't, some people might, I wouldn't call him a Dharma king. Some might do that. That's fine. That's fine. Dharma king may even be even more skillful, in seeing the entire picture at all moments. Avo, was it Avalokiteshvara, the bodhisattva of all awareness, that's a totally aware of every single one of us constantly. It's very interesting because that's exactly the Holy Spirit in Christianity. Was it Avalokiteshvara? Something like that. Avalokiteshvara. It's like, sounds to be like the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit is aware of every single one of us constantly, and no call for help goes unheeded. This is exactly what Avalokiteshvara is in Buddhism. Exactly the same as Christianity. The Holy Spirit is that, Jesus tells us, every little bit of willingness we have, the Holy Spirit immediately uses it. It's completely aware of everyone at all, every moment, ever vigilant. Exactly the same as Avalokiteshvara in Buddhism. Exactly the same. It shouldn't be any big surprise. I mean, they're just, we're seeing everything. The truth is the same for everyone. There's not a, you know, Christian truth and a Buddhist truth. It's just one truth. The truth of reality, truth of God, truth of isness. So A Course in Miracles can absolutely bring us to clear perception. Absolutely. And this ecumenical type of speech here, I believe it helps. It helps me. People may be a little less put off if you say, well, Jesus, you know, did this and this and this is Jesus, Jesus. People, I mean, traditional Christians, boy, they don't like that. Say the least. And then you start getting all these arguments and clashes. But if you say, well, some obscure, you know, Tibetan Buddhist, some obscure Tibetan Buddhist lived in a cave, somebody's just like, help, you know, help me out, and is my guru, my teacher, and it's like, oh, that's kind of cool. You're like, really? They're just like, they don't really know, you know, what to make of it, actually. And a lot of people are kind of open to that because they're kind of feeling like Christianity's kind of been putting them in a box. So it's just like, you can't go to Christians and say, oh, well, Jesus is back and he has A Course in Miracles and he explained everything and this is how it really is. And then they say, what? What? What are you talking about? Now we know that's true, but there's still, I always feel this kind of like potential backlash from it. So I just, you know, have been able to introduce this full stop in the wow. There's this practice, you can say, there's this practice that really has really works for me. And I can only explain it just like, wow. You know, don't revisit, get some glimpse of pure perception, and then don't go back and try to explain or revisit or anything. So I can't really explain to you, you know, the whole idea is don't explain. That's the discipline, is don't explain. And when you practice not explaining, you find that these glimpses of pure perception increase and increase and increase. So just let it happen. Just do it. Just do it. Just do it. I really wish I could get this somehow to... Let me back and do it somehow, so I can cover myself like that. Yeah, okay. There you go. Just do it like that. I'm getting a little cold out here. I found a way. I found a way. How about that? Full Dharma protection here. Maybe that symbolizes it. It's just telling me it is the way of no explanation is the way it actually works. So you're asking me for an explanation. That would undermine the path that I'm teaching. I'm teaching you the way of no explanation. I will explain how to practice this path. But again, the discipline is don't ask for explanation. Practice no accepting no explanation. And in doing this, you will find inherently arising within you, these breakthroughs will happen. Now, did that insect just come back? Or is it, yeah. Or is that just my scalp? I don't know. It's just... That's weird. Maybe it's just my scalp. I don't know. Because in the same place, it's got to be an insect. It was. It's an insect. But why did it go back in the same place? That's funny. Exactly the same place. Exactly, yeah. It's all the same. Very good. And the trouble is always the same trouble, isn't it? Hasn't changed at all. The tricks haven't changed at all. We kept thinking we could change our tricky defenses, but we can't change them. We have to actually have the skillful means to avoid getting pulled into them. But it's good to know that you can't change them. So that means when you solve them, you solve them. That's it. They can't change. It's the same. I realize that. The same tricks that pull me down are still there exactly the same as they were before. I haven't modified them in any way through all my efforts. And yet, we can find a way to not be pulled down by them. So, I recommend the way of no explanation. Practicing no explanation. So, the explanation I give is just basically how to practice no explanation. And why that's helpful. And then actually do it. I can't just spend all my time explaining why it's helpful, because that's still just explaining. So it has to be actually practiced. Don't go back to your insight. And only you can do it. Because when you have your insights, and only you can decide whether am I going to go back and revisit it or not. And when you have faith that it will, as you get stronger at this, whatever needs to arise will arise within you. Then you won't go back and revisit it, and you will feel fundamentally different, that you're fundamentally in charge of your path, and you know you're going to be enlightened. When you do this practice, you know you've got the answer. It's like that. This is why I do these videos. I know I have the answer, and I know I'm going to be enlightened, because in doing this practice, it's you know it. You know it. It's the knockout blow. Now, the ego takes a while to fall to the canvas, but it's falling. Just let it fall. You deliver the knockout blow. This. So when you refuse to revisit an insight, a powerful insight, you will feel fundamentally different. And this will generate a huge wow in its own right, which then don't revisit that insight either. Just keep doing that. But you will feel, you will know, like, I've got it. You know, this is it. This is it. I've got it. And I'm going to be enlightened. There's no doubt about it. It's a done deal. It's a done deal. You will feel that you'll know it. You'll know it. And this, it gives you a different perspective. Confidence. It gives you confidence. It gives confidence and poise. When that man in the elevator said, How are you? I'm good. He said, are you sure you're good? Which is a trick. And I said, I absolutely am. I'm absolutely, yes, I am. I am sure that I'm good. And he was like, wow. I gave him a really strong wow, actually. He didn't expect that at all. Because most people will laugh and kind of say, well, you know, I hope I feel good. And then they'll equivocate. I didn't equivocate. I just shot right back. I says, yes, I am sure I'm good. He was really stunned. Because I am sure. I'm good. I am sure. And you can say the same thing. When you do this practice, you will be able to say the same thing. You'll say, yeah, I am sure. No doubt about it. This cuts through this in the negative cycle that pulled me down. It cuts through it. The way of no explanation. And those who have done it know this. They can use it different terms. The way of no way, the Tao of no Tao, the path of no path, you know, the self of no self, whatever. You say, it's the same. It's just the way of no explanation. So you're in Biden's, you're not revisiting a Biden's. I'm not revisiting anything. I'm not explaining anything. I'm not looking for any explanation. And you're advising others to do the same. Don't go back and try to explain. Don't revisit it. Don't revisit the Biden's. Because first you have to leave it to revisit it, right? So if you're in the habit of revisiting, how can you be in abidance? You'll leave it so that you can revisit it, to try and strengthen it. You see? Don't try to strengthen abidance. This is what brings us out of it. A fear of delayed reaction to abidance? There isn't any, actually. But our habit of revisiting to try and strengthen, to forestall some delayed reaction, that's what causes us to lose the abidance in the first place. And then we think, oh, there's the delayed reaction. So, you know, this is a huge wow right now. I mean, this is just really extraordinary. So now I have to not revisit this explanation right now. See how that works? I recognize the wow. I said, wow, oh wow. You know, this is super profound. So right away, I have to drop the explanation and give prominence, preference to the wow. Priority, give priority to the wow. Preference, priority, prominence. Suddenly I just shifted real quickly like that. You see, that's like shifting. Shift a car, just downshift real quick. Okay, I better downshift here real quick. Now I'm in the wow. And you know what brought upon the wow? I don't remember. You know, I'm not trying to think about it. And you know, I don't remember what I was talking about. I don't try. So I just right now I'm just this feeling, this kind of jittery of the wow, like, wow. I must have said something pretty amazing. So I'm just watching the wow carefully to see, you know, is there some delayed, really some sneak delayed reaction actually, or is this just a wow that you would expect out of continuity fear? You know, is that? So we're here, we're practicing, I would say, every bit as effective as any Vajrayana Buddhist has ever practiced, no matter what their practice may be, but no matter what tantric technique anyone might have ever used, this technique right here is just as powerful as any of them, just as effective. So why should I go digging around for some other treasure when I have where my digging right here is coming across the mother lode? Maybe the mother lode stretches for miles and miles and miles. Like they say there's one that stretches through the Sierras for like 600 miles. A mother lode of gold in the middle of the Sierras. You just can't get to it very easily, actually. So let's say you dig in someplace. You get to it. You hit the mother lode. Well, somebody else may be digging 100 miles away. They get to it too. Why should I go off looking for some other place when I hit the mother lode? No, don't. Just stay with it. Stay with it. Same mother load. I mean, Longchenpa is not going to invite me onto his team if we've gone over that before. Let's just stay with a while. You know, obviously. See, sometimes you have to short circuit something that seems interesting, but it'll lead you astray. If the wow is powerful, you have to make sure that there's no delayed reaction and just stay with it. Just keep your attention on it. Just keep your attention on this feeling. Like, hey, I just hit the mother lode. Wow. Can I handle this? Or I'm going to have some sort of, you know, apoplectic reaction. I'm going to have the jitters and the heebie-jeebies and the, you know, whatever you want to call it, the jumping Jehoshaphats and the meltdown and the freak out and the mind blowing and you know, whatever lingo you want to use. Am I going to have that? And so you got to keep your attention on the wow and just say, no, it seems pretty smooth. And if you just keep your attention on it, after a while, you'll become less and less concerned about some sort of delayed reaction. But certainly, there's a fear about it. Is my heart going to start pounding? Am I going to start frothing at the mouth? Am I going to have a seizure? Am I going to this? You know, all this, all these potential fears, you know, might be kind of gurgling around a bit. It just, but don't, nothing in particular. Don't even, it's just, you just watch the wow and they don't happen. You know, nothing bad happens. It's all good. You know, breathing is steady, fine. At least it wasn't until I talked about it. It was just happening by itself until I said, well, started my attention to my breathing now. Like, oh, how am I supposed to breathe? You know, I messed it up. So don't think about your breathing. Very important. Don't even think about your breathing. Is it fine or not fine? I don't know. I just know I'm feeling the wow. So this wow is powerful enough where potential troubles are kicking around there. And just have to stay centered in the wow and don't try to do anything. Don't try to get rid of it. I hadn't had macaroni salad in quite some time. It's one of my favorites, and I decided I got to treat myself, and I got some. Wow, was it good? It was great. I put in some green Tabasco sauce in there. It really helps it out big time. So I have to just let all this calm down. Just let it calm down. Don't try to make it calm down. Let it calm down. Don't try to do anything. It'll calm down on its own. Kind of like if you're running really fast and you say, I gotta catch my breath. Well, you just stop running then. And then naturally, eventually, right, what'll happen? Well, your body doesn't need as much oxygen. So we don't need, our breath doesn't have to be so frantic to get, you know, oxygen so it can help be good in the blood and be transported to the cells. It doesn't need as much. So the breathing just slows down on its own without us trying to force it. It'll just slow down on its own. It's similar to this. Wow, it just slows, it sort of fades on its own. As we refuse to revise our clarity, the clarity is remains, actually. It's there. And then we start getting confidence, like, oh, it really is true. I really did see it. Oh, I really can rely upon this. And then the wow starts dissipating. See, the wow comes up partially because we think, wow, I got it, but, hey, but something might happen to it, right? So We have faith. Nothing's going to happen to it. Nothing's going to happen to it. I don't need to defend it. Doesn't need any defense. It's effortless victory. Doesn't need any defense. I'm not going to defend it at all. So this fits in with Jesus in A Course in Miracles saying, when I defend myself, I'm attacked. And the way to peace comes from, you know, no defense. I don't defend myself at all. Therein lies the peace of God. Therein lies the safety of God. So this practice works, and we have a better understanding now, really, of why it works. And it just, but we're not going to try and belabor or struggle with that, those explanations. Down the road, we'll get it. We'll really understand it and be very adamant and clear about it and help others. Just the fact that there is a practice we can all easily do like this that does work. That liberates us from weirdness. That itself is very encouraging. Keep in mind that the psyche of people, like in wartime, for instance, the Nazis tried to destroy the psyche, the confidence of England, Britain, I think Scotland and England. And by bombing the Luftwaffe, the massive raids on London, they were trying to destroy their psyche. It was an attempt to demoralize them. So demoralization is a very, very powerful tool that in warfare. You try to do whatever you can to demoralize the people, the population. But they were unsuccessful. The British, to stiff upper lip, they said, hey, yeah, they refused to be demoralized. Winston Churchill helped them at that. There was somebody there that just said, no, we will absolutely refuse to be demoralized. In fact, the more they bomb us, the more resolute we become. That's coming up big time. That's big time. By other countries, they were able to demoralize them. So, working, helping people not get demoralized is really helpful. If they can see that there's freedom to be won, there's a way to practice that can win the freedom, get us there, you know, and if they could see that, then they won't be so easily demoralized. Especially when you start practicing this, and you realize that, hey, this, I've got it, I can do it. This practice will work, I can see it, I can do it. Wow. I'm going to make it. Then it's real tough to be demoralized. People cannot demoralize you, really. Very difficult. Which is why the forces of weirdness that are trying to bring about this weirdness, they don't want anybody, they don't want the Dharma kings and queens to help us out and spread the protect pure perception, and they don't want that, you know, because that makes people very difficult to demoralize. They want to demoralize people easily, and they've set them up for that by watching television and movies and all this. What's really is setting people up to be easily demoralized. That's what they want. And once they feel that enough people will be very easily demoralized, then that's when they, you know, push the button on their plan, get it rolling of weirdness, really severe weirdness. That's when they roll out the weirdness. And feeling confident, it'll demoralize the population. And you know, this is how they work. That's how they roll. They don't want us getting real help. That they want to divert that into innocuous, you know, dancing. You go to a Dzogchen center maybe or something, the people are like doing some dance, and they, you know, they're, you know, how to be, you know, relationship counseling and how to be more effective in your life. And it's all this stuff has been diverted into innocuous stuff where, you know, you're really not recognizing your house is on fire. You kind of think everything's okay, and we just kind of need to smooth out our relationships and be more motivated in our job, and this will help us be more peaceful and calm and empower our compassionate wisdom to help people out. And all that, you know, sounds great, right? But this is not like Longchenpa in a cave, right? Meditating and using the Vajra blade to cut through all absurdity and all tricks and all delay, just cutting right through it, powering through to clear light. And that's not what's going on really here. It's all been, you know, it's wishy-washy. I mean, even the Tibetan Buddhism is becoming wishy-washy, and Dzogchen, you see Dzogchen Center, this, that. I mean, it's become very wishy-washy, like Christianity has come very wishy-washy, very watered down. They're not practicing like their house is on fire. No, not at all. You kind of, you know, a bunch of yuppies who just kind of want to feel, you know, pad their yuppie resume. Pretty much so. You know, they may have a, you know, well, really, they view it as compassion. Compassion, I got to pad my compassion resume, and I'm a rich yuppie, I got it made, and I know I'm better off than 99% of the world, and what can I do to kind of assuage that, you know, survival guilt, success guilt? Maybe if I can do some compassionate action, that'd be nice. So maybe I'll listen to some talks in Tibetan Buddhism or Dzogchen, and, you know, get some clue about how can I be more compassionate, you know, that kind of thing. They're just trying to get rid of guilt of success, material success, most of them. I don't have that problem. I don't have any material success. I'm on the bottom, really on the bottom. I'm so on the bottom that even the, you know, the poor people know how to work the system. They get all this public assistance. This, that. I don't even get that. I'm really on the bottom. So I don't feel any guilt about success that way. So I'm not looking to find some way to be compassionate to help my guilt. My house is on fire. There's weirdness is coming. The Dharma is about, you know, we could lose pure perception. We could lose the whole scent of pure perception. This is a disaster that's coming. It's an unprecedented disaster is coming. So your house is on blazing on fire. I mean, you need Longchenpa to show up in there. So, you know, Dharma King or Queen to show up and say, hey, come on, you know, you want to be part of my court, you gotta earn it there. Come on, you got to know what you're doing. You gotta have a practice, a successful practice, and you have to really know what you're doing with that practice. You really gotta understand it and do it the right way. So get after it every single day. I just get after it all day long, just getting after it. I got no time for television or movies or anything. Our house is on fire. The weirdness is coming. It's at our doorstep. So we have to master the practice. Really, we have to be master practitioners at this point. Seriously. At the very least, be master practitioners and hopefully reach abidance. And abide in the seatless seat, the unexplainable. Unexplainable. So, I have to admit, I'm feeling kind of hungry. I ate today, I don't know. There's a cumulative effect, maybe. Over the last week and a half, I haven't eaten that much. And feeling the burn, plus all the ab work I did. I really hit it hard today. Not too hard, but hard enough to where I'm feeling. And I run into so many people who, just yesterday, I asked a guy, I mean, you play golf? He says, no, I got a bad back. I said, well, you do like core work to help your back? He says, every morning, 20 minutes, I want to get up. He said, I've been doing it for over 20 years. Every morning I get up and do core work to keep my back, as healthy as possible, and just to keep myself moving. Because when you start getting up in age, wow, you get up in the morning and your body can't hardly move. It's crazy. I said, what happened? I just lying in bed and this happened? So really, I mean, if you do stretching before you go to bed, that's also really helpful. And then stretch when you get up in the morning. If you combine those two, you feel pretty good as you get older. And I know a lot of older people I've talked to now my age, they're doing all of that. And it's like, this guy, yeah, this guy, yeah, this guy, yeah. I say, hey, wait a minute. I mean, we're all doing pretty much the same thing. Pretty interesting, isn't it? And I reached a point where I realized if I don't do this, I'm going to just, I'll be like one of those rotund, immobile Buddhas who, laughing Buddha type. I said, well, that's good too. But I kind of feel like I need to fit into the culture here. And we're in like such a insanely athletic culture right now. You fit in a little better if you look athletic and that you can move around. At least in California, we have an athletic culture, but I think it's global. I think it's worldwide. I mean, people are in shape. At least a certain class of people. There's another class of people who are just like grotesquely overweight. You don't particularly want to be lumped in with that class. You might call them the lumpen proletariat. Proletariat as a play on words. They're pretty lumpy, all right. Because they're just, eating junk food and all the hormones and all the meat and stuff they're eating and then all the carbs and soft drinks. I mean, they're just like so many obese people. But like if you go like to Palo Alto, go to like a store, Palo Alto, it's weird. I mean, everybody is thin. It's just so, you never see a Palo Altan that's obese, a native Palo Altan for sure. They're like twig thin. Very interesting. So you want to give them a chance, really, if they can relate to you better that way. Maybe there's some that can get this who are among the intelligentsia, cultural elite, all these, those who are higher, they think they're higher echelon, and there may be some that can actually start to practice this way as possible. And there may be just the ones that really get it are the mavericks that just, they're just destined to get it. This is what they came here for. And they can be of any social class at all, really. You never know where they come from. But there are some who are real sharp-minded that might be able to, I don't know, we'll find out. So they might find me easier to relate to and especially in California too, in the West, if someone, looks like they're thin and fit and sharp and all this kind of like, kind of like me. That's like me. That's like me. So. And first appearances, are people tend to draw inferences and conclusions on first appearances, first impressions. That's true. We kind of do, don't we? We kind of do, unless you're really keen and say, hey, let's see what's really here. Let me see what's going on here. But people are working out. They really are, because they know something's coming. But of course, the spiritual work of this mastering this practice, that's the real workout. That's the number one workout. That's what's crucial. That we know what we're doing. Don't revisit the insight under any circumstances. Refuse to do so. When you notice the wow coming up, then shift into the wow, and you're done with the insight. You're not going to revisit it under any circumstances. No way. Not now. Maybe later, but not now. And just absolutely do that. And you will realize, hey, I'm kind of a Dharma prince here. I mean, this is putting me into that territory right now. Really, it is. When you're practicing such a high practice and doing it and mastering it, that's a Dharma prince. Basically, when Dharma prince is one who's mastered a practice like this, really. So you're on the path to being a Dharma prince or princess. Absolutely, you are. Longchenpa, well, again, I'm not going to dive into that. It's more important to just the wow of like, hey, you're on the road to being a Dharma prince. That's what's more important. Just focus on that. It's about you, not about me. Here, just say, I'm definitely on the path of being a Dharma prince or a princess. Absolutely, I am. Wow. And accept it. Accept it. Wow, I really am on this path. No question about it. And I just sit quietly with that and the wow of that. You've seen it. You realize it's true, and then don't revisit it. That's good enough. You've seen it. It's there. Mayday, mayday, what is that? Going down, right? Playing mayday, mayday. Something's sinking, something's going down. We're in this May period now where it's mayday, all right. So we're certainly aware that time, the clock is ticking, and so we're adamant here. Have to be adamant, yeah, but we're getting it. We're getting it. We're getting it. I have this amazing gift that's I don't know how I have it or how I have it. I'm always on time. In terms of, someone says, when are you going to get here? And there's all these hoops I got to jump through. I said, wow. And I kind of think and say, okay, I think I believe it. I'll be there at this time. And you know what? I'll walk in the door right when the second hand hits that time. Without even trying to do it, it just works out. It works out that way almost 100% of the time with me. It's just, I cannot explain it. So, I'll be on time. You know, I'll get it done just in time. It's just always the way it works with me. It's just really almost inexplicable. And funnily enough, when I give a time, I'm going to be there, and I'm early without even thinking about it. What happens is I'll make a wrong turn. I say, "Wow, what did I do that for? I know where to turn," and I'll get lost, or I gotta go around here and turn around, and I end up wasting like 10 minutes or something by you know, trouble driving or trouble something, and then I end up walking in right exactly on the dot. That way, too. Even if I try to be early, I end up being on time. It's very strange. Sometimes I try to be early, and usually something happens where I end up, nope, still coming right on time. So, but being on time is good enough here. You know, being on time is fine. Being on time is fine. Seems to make it for a nice, smooth continuity issue, right? Yeah, the trouble arises, the weirdness arises, and you walk into the room and say, "Oh, yeah, I'm enlightened, and so here we go, and we start cooling this down now. You know, the firefighters are here. Yeah, put out the fire." And people might say, "Wow, what a great coincidence that was," or just, "I mean, that sure is good timing." And yeah. So I don't worry about, you know, when the weirdness will hit. I try not to think about it. I know I'll be ready, and that means that those who practice this practice here will have somebody who really understands it and is not going to lose it. It's not going to lose sight of it. And so you'll be helped to keep on doing the practice and succeed at it yourself. Have confidence in it. And that will greatly help with the weirdness problem. Greatly help with the weirdness problem that's coming up. It's like taking refuge. It really is like taking refuge. Take refuge in the core of the Dharma King, as I have said, which is protecting our pure perception from falling down into just this ordinary, whimsical, delusional perception. It protects it. Take refuge in the core of the Dharma King. It protects it. Protects it. Wonderful protection. Okay, well, how are we doing here? Yeah, getting up there in time. That's good. It's really good. I advise again for me. I keep working out. I'm going to see if I can keep pushing it here. I will see if I can get the motivation to actually push it even more. Physically working out, so I've got to avoid my neck seizing up. That happens because this whole shoulder area tightens up and that pulls the neck out. This is why it happens. I talked to a bodybuilder today, or was it yesterday? He explained to me exactly why it happens and what you need to do. They actually have somebody give him a back massage and use their elbows and knead the muscles and get all that nervous tension out of there, out of the whole shoulder area, so they don't seize up and the neck goes out. I don't have anyone to do that, so I have to find some way to you know, do that myself. You know, push against something that is kind of more, you know, kind of pointed or cone-like, that loosens up all the shoulder muscles around the shoulder blades and stuff. That whole area has a tendency to knot up, and then that'll pull your neck out of alignment, and before you know it, you got this terrible stiff neck, which I still have it. It's still sore. I have this horrible stiff neck and sore neck, and it's still lingering on. It's like, wow, really bad. But you have to be careful when you do like upper body exercises that this doesn't happen. And running, you have to be careful of the knees. You start getting some pain in the knees, like, uh-oh, better back off. So you have to be aware of, don't push it too hard. Just like in spiritual practice, don't push it too hard. If you start feeling, troubles, you back off, back off. Don't push it too hard. You'll get there. And don't forget the tough stuff, the abs. Just like in spiritual practice, don't forget really practicing full stop on the wow, not revisiting the insight. That's like core work. It's really spiritual core work is what it is. It really is. And those who do bodybuilding or our fitness know that the core work is what ties it all together. That's what's vitally important. That's why these golfers can take a nice easy swing and just, drill it 300 y yards in the air. They're so strong and flexible in their core. They're obsessed with core work. It helps their golf game immensely. So, absolutely strengthen your core both physically and spiritually. Keep at it. Keep at it. It will pay great dividends. It's the best way to invest your time. And coming up, we may have to practice full stop in the wow a lot, a lot, a lot. Tremendous amount, actually. You're just gonna have to keep the equilibrium. Like, wow, that's really weird. Okay, that's really weird. Wow, full stop in the wow. That's it. Let me not think of it again anymore and not revisit it. And just allow myself to calm down from that. And in this way, the whole thing gets muted. You just mute the whole situation. Put it on mute. Put the horn on mute. Put the violin. I know the violins have mute. Maybe not. But the horns sure do. Put the horns on mute. Pianos have kind of a mute pedal. I think they do. I think like when you hit a chord, then you put the other keys on mute or something. I'm not exactly sure how that works. Or you want to stop. If you want to stop a reverberation, you put the mute button, you mute pedal, and it quiets everything just like that. So yeah, you can you gotta we have to be able to mute the weirdness, mute our reactions. Absolutely, we do. And we'll help out with that here. Dharma princes and princesses will help out with that. Those who've mastered the practice will help out, help others, help them mute their reactions. And I may not be looking at what's happening in the world at all. It's not doesn't matter. See, whatever weirdness there is, it's got to be muted. So it doesn't really matter what the form takes. The form of it doesn't really matter. It's whatever it is. Just practice effectively. That's my viewpoint. Whatever it is, just practice effectively. So, I'm experiencing that. I mean, with the 9/11, I never paid any attention to it. Didn't watch any TV on it. You could say I paid very little attention to it. Very little attention to it. Extremely little attention. And years later, I looked just a little bit. But I already understood what happened. I already knew what happened. So, and then, the Indonesian tsunami, I paid no attention to it. I already knew what was going to happen, and it happened, and I didn't need to pay any attention to it. And the Japanese Fukushima earthquake, tsunami, Fukushima tsunami, I didn't pay attention to that either, really. Very, very little attention. Very little. No video, no pictures, nothing like that. But, you know, you heard that there's some trouble and, you know, you could... It filters through. And just a lot of other stuff. I'm not paying attention to politics at all right now or sports or anything. So I'm really good at just not paying any attention to stuff that other people are just freaking out about. I don't even look at it. I don't even look at it. So if there's some huge tsunami, I'll just say, well, you know, whatever is causing it doesn't really matter to me. The practice is the same. So it's just like, okay, wow, it's very intense. Okay, wow, I'm not going to, I just trust it that there's something is indeed intense, and I'm just going to let the wow subside and not even revisit what it is that caused the wow. And just have faith that something caused the wow, and you know, you could use it that way to mute your responses, actually. And I did use it. I've used it in all these catastrophes to basically not even be bothered by them at all. Now, what was bothersome is the reaction to 9/11 is the loss of all our freedoms, so many freedoms. I mean, that's really tough to take. You know, that the fundamental change in our society of people not trusting one another and not being able to just freewheel it like you used to, that has really been terrible. That's the bad, you know, the worst part of it. Wow. I know a lot of people don't even fly anymore. So it's not worth it. Forget it. Don't travel anymore. Forget it. It's not worth it to me. I don't like it. Someone just telling me they're traveling to Lebanon, you know, Beirut and Middle East and all this. And we asked, how's the travel through Turkey and Greece and all this stuff? He said, you wouldn't believe how difficult it is. You know, it takes him 24 hours. Took him 24 hours to get from Europe to Beirut. It is so difficult. It is such a pain. It's just, he said, it's just horribly difficult. We went through 7 different checkpoints in the airport in Lebanon. 7 different checkpoints. I mean, they screen and rescreen and rescreen and rescreen and rescreen. And he says, well, it's fine because, you know, you get the sense of confidence on the flight. But it is such a hassle. It is so much trouble. Oh, so, you know, the things are just, it's just terrible, the stuff. The fears we all live in for terrorism. And any, you never know, you wake up in the morning and, you know, something horrible has happened. And it just, all this stuff is so horrible. So... it's, you know, it's just best to, you know, really not pay any attention to it. And just feel so wonderful that you're, you know, you are going towards abundance and pure perception, which realizes there's no entrapment at all. Nothing is happening. Everything's eternal life. Right now. Vision of oneness, as Jesus says, vision of eternal life. Vision of absolute sameness. This is what we're going towards here. And we're going towards, doing pretty good on this video, actually. Going up to our limit on this one, which would be about 2.5 hours. Ouch, my calf just, muscle just suddenly spasmed up. Wow, that hurt. I do stretch my calves every morning very intensely. That's really important. Tight calves lead to reactions up the muscles of the leg, which then pull your back out. It's the number one reason for back problems is your calves are too tight because of all the driving we do. We're sitting in a car with our right foot, accelerator, brake, accelerator, brake, accelerator, brake. Your calf gets too tight, and this will pull your back out, cause your back to go out. So usually when the back goes out, just keep working on your calves and just keep working on loosening your calves up. Just like when your neck goes out, work on loosening your shoulders. It's kind of like a chain reaction in the body. Some doctors are experts in that, like chiropractors are supposed to understand the chain reaction, and there's a pain here, they say, yeah, but it's really, you know, started from here, and it's worked its way down to there, so I got to fix it up here, and then this one will, you know, subside, and, you know, good chiropractors, they help out, they can help. Absolutely. I know someone who had this real bad back problem and has to work carrying heavy things, and doctors couldn't do anything about it. They went to a chiropractor, and the chiropractor just said, okay, and he just like cracked all these bones, like, oh, suddenly shifted everything, and the pain was gone. Just boom. He walked out of there, said pain-free, and it never came back. Of course. Too much of a good thing. I mean, chiropractors tend to think they can cure everything. It's all just in the bones, you know. So they kind of overplay their hand. You know, it's just acupressure point. Just kind of put my hand, finger right there, and then right there, and just balancing out your energy field, and that can be overplayed. The answer is right spiritual practice. This is the real answer to our stress and our trouble. This is where it really comes from, is that negative spiral we talked about. That's where it really comes from. That's what really works its way down through our body, actually, through our psyche, through our body. Absolutely, that's what's really happening. So, hey, that's good news. Once we really get this practice and ultimately we succeed, that'll work down to our body too. I'm in the seatless seat. I'm abiding in the explanation, free explanation, free freeness. The no explanation, no explanation. And the body will just reflect that. Body will reflect that. Will be, I don't know, very, very flexible and have all the necessary energy to do whatever we need to do. Jesus says our body will do work perfectly for whatever we need to do. We'll work perfectly and don't even have to think about it. Okay, so we're getting close to wrapping this up. And so again, we've really focused in on what abidance. And we're really intensively doing this. Why? There's severe weirdness is coming up soon. Quickly, like a thief of the night. Severe weirdness. So we have to be confident in our approach. The goal. And continue to reinforce this and get there. Very important. No time to be fooling around right now. Wow, I'm interested in how I feel tomorrow morning. I'm feeling really hungry right now. I'm going to push it through till tomorrow morning. See what the scale says. Kind of feels like it's amazing. Well, you thin up and then one day you suddenly recognize, oh my gosh, I'm really thin. But then you get used to it and you just feel normal. It's like, I don't feel thin right now. I just feel like normal. Some point you'd suddenly say, oh gosh, I'm really thin. I didn't know if I'd ever get that way again, but it seems like I'm getting sort of that way now. It's interesting. The mind, I'm a little tired. The mind's starting to wander. I have to bring it back. So, very great. We've done it. We've done it.